Good evening, everyone who all have joined in early. It's truly a pleasure to welcome you all. Give us some more time. We are waiting for more guests to come in. And also, one of our panelists is about to join in. Meanwhile, just enjoy the evening. Have a great time. And we'll be back in a while. Hi, Sonia.
Hello. Good evening. How are you?
I'm doing good. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
I think our guests have also joined in.
Yes, I can see
Manika,
three of them. Dr. Gupta is joining a bit late. He's really unwell, and but he'll come. So he said, I'm committed to it. So if I can be excused for some time. So I said, yeah, please. Luckily, you're the third speaker. So he's running fever. So, yeah. But that's we have others, yes.
So I think three, 4 more minutes. I think we've just sent the last reminder, considering it's a freak day. People are just joining in. I've got some more messages. 4 or 5 more minutes and we will start.
Sure. So, good evening, Dr. Krishna, and I can see Rajiv also logged in.
Hey,
so, good evening.
Hi, Sonia.
And yes,
hi,
Manika. Hi.
Hi,
Ma.
Hi, how are you?
Very good evening. Good. How are you?
Good.
Dr. Krishna, hi, Dr. good evening. Krishna. All good.
Yeah, so I heard that he's running fever.
Yes.
He's all safe.
Yes, we spoke and I asked him if you've got your test done. So he smiled and Rajiv, good evening. How are you?
Hi, good evening. How are you, Sonia? Hi, everyone.
Absolutely.
Hi, Rajiv. Hello, everyone. Absolutely.
Yes, hello, Dr. Krishna. Hello, Manika.
Hi, Dr. Rajiv. How are you? How, Dr. Krishna?
Yes. I'm not a doctor, but I would love to be one.
I knew this was coming from Rajiv. The moment Manika said, "Hi, Dr. Rajiv," I knew that. I don't have to correct. I think Rajiv himself will say that I want to be a doctor. But,
with the someone can gain, it should automatically come to Rajiv for sure.
Yes, with the wisdom and with all the experience.
Thank you.
But Rajiv, होना चाहिए ना कॉर्पोरेट के लोगों के लिए भी मतलब एक डॉक्टरेट डिग्री होनी चाहिए
बड़े सारे लोग आते हैं ऑफर करते हैं ऑफर नो देयर आर लॉट्स ऑफ पीपल हु कम ऑफर सम फॉर फ्री सम फॉर पेड आई रिफ्यूज एवरीबॉडी नो सो इफ वन हैज टू अर्न ए डिग्री यू नो वन शुड अर्न विद यू नो द रियल वर्क व्हिच वन डज यू नो नॉट रियली बाय यू नो लॉट ऑफ पीपल हु जस्ट offer it on the slide. But Manika,
no, nothing at all. See, I sensed it. I didn't put it like that. That's fine.
So, you know, today we were interviewing somebody for a very important position in IIT Delhi. And there was someone who had done the doctorate from IGNU. And nothing against IGNU or whatever, but when we kind of probed a little bit deeper, one really found that, you know, the material on which he got the doctorate was really not there.
Sure. So we will wait a little longer for others to join.
In a minute or two, I guess. I think we can start. Sonia, over to you.
We can?
Your call, please.
Okay. Great.
It's 6:02, so we should start. Sure.
And I'm sure people will keep joining in. By another 5 or 7 minutes, we would have a lot of them joining in. All right.
They will join in.
Yes. Sure. So a warm good evening to everybody. My name is Sonia, and I am an educator and a professional storyteller. And along with that, I am a mindfulness practitioner. And thank you so much to CBL and StoryNAC for giving me this wonderful opportunity to host this super special evening. And you'll figure out that why am I using this word super special? Because, you know, the kind of speakers we have today, I'm going to talk about them in a while. But before that, I have something very basic in my hand, which is a bulb, a basic light bulb. I'm just trying to figure out how do we enhance its light. Well, we have a lot of engineers and a lot of literate people, and I know that they know the answer, the drop of their, you know, back of their hand. So without wasting much time, there are two ways I know that we can increase its light is A, we increase the capacity, or we increase the current supply that is passing through this bulb. That's the way we'll enhance or we'll increase the light. Now, why this little analogy is to introduce mindfulness. Mindfulness is also exactly like this. It enhances the voltage, not of this bulb, but of us. It enhances the physical, spiritual, and the emotional reverberance of us as human beings. And thereby, makes us more effective, makes us more productive in whatever we do and wherever we go. Quite often, we use the term mindfulness and meditation interchangeably. Well, a lot of people do that. I'm not saying that you shouldn't do that, but all I'm trying to say is that there's a stark difference between the two. While meditation can be looked upon as a process, a journey you want to embark on, mindfulness in literal sense of the word is a step that you take towards that journey. While meditation is looked upon as a process, mindfulness is an outcome, is not a process. Another thing that I can say is meditation is about channelizing the awareness. Mindfulness is about cultivating that awareness. Now, I understand that today's session is not about me talking about mindfulness or giving you a lot of W's and H about mindfulness, but we have eminent leaders from various walks of life who each one of them is going to engage us with their enlightening conversation around authors, books, and their personal experience about this wonderful topic, like CBL has named, beautiful mind, or in simple terms, mindfulness. How each one of them has been mindful of their life using, as I say, the power of books or the power of authors. And all the speakers and that we have today, all our guests that we have today amongst us are super achievers. वो इतने पहुंचे हुए हैं एक एक स्पीकर जो हमारे साथ हैं मैं बताती हूँ क्यों यूजुअली जब मैं इंट्रोडक्शन पढ़ती हूँ या नोट्स पढ़ती हूँ तो मुझे वो दो लाइन या तीन लाइन में याद हो जाता है कि हाँ क्या बोलना है बट आज के सेशन में मोहित आपको अलाउ करना पड़ेगा मुझे नोट्स रेफर करने के लिए, बिकॉज ईच ऑफ देम हैज अचीव्ड सो मच दैट आई डोंट वांट टू गो रॉन्ग, आई डोंट वांट टू मिस आउट. सो विदाउट एनी फर्दर ड्यू, अलाउ मी टू इंट्रोड्यूस आवर फर्स्ट स्पीकर डॉक्टर कृष्णा वेंकटेश, अबाउट हुम स्पेसिफिकली when I was reading his bio, when I was reading about him, what has he done and what has he achieved, I was like, in no way I can remember all of this. So I'm not going to read all of it, but he's someone that after a long time, I have come across somebody who has not stopped learning. So Dr. Krishna has over 20 years of experience in the corporate sector, including 5 years as the CEO of a conglomerate and another 20 years of experience as an academic leader and distinguished professor of strategy and international business. He has a bachelor's degree in engineering, a master's in system, another master's in business administration. And ladies and gentlemen, he's got not one, but 2 doctorate degrees, one in project management and one in strategy. He's also won a lot of awards. I would mention 1 or 2 of them because the list is huge. United States of America has honored him with Education Leader of the Year Award. They have also honored him as the Teaching Excellence Award. He has innumerable experience in strategy, innovation, analytics, knowledge management, and I can go on and on about him. But the best part is, along with this, he's really a big custodian of how mindful is he about his life and how a few books has changed the way he looks at these concepts, be it meditation or mindfulness or a holistic overview of body, mind and soul. So my dear friends, I know we are in a virtual workshop or a webinar and I can't see you, but I genuinely want you to welcome Dr. Krishna Venkatesh with a thundering round of applause. And trust me, I can hear you. If you will clap, we all will hear you. So over to you, Dr. Krishna Venkatesh.
Thank you very much. Can you all hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Good evening to everyone. My gratitude to Sonia and the other organizers. And greetings to my esteemed co-panelists. And my very warm wishes to all those who have tuned in. Thank you very much. Deeply appreciate it. I think a little bit of context would help. Sonia has already explained something about mindfulness. And the first thing that we need to understand is mindfulness is not about the mind per se. It's about the whole body. And my first introduction to this was when I was barely 12, attending the School of Advaita Studies and studying the philosophy of non-dualism. Before our classes started, we had to do the morning prayers, and part of the prayers involved touching various parts of the body, like the eyes, the nostrils, the ears, the shoulders, and the navel, and the heart, and the head, and so on. That was my first introduction to what I today understand as mindfulness. And the process of breathing itself, the very ancient practice of pranayama, even today it is prevalent in different forms of meditation, deep breathing exercises. And this essentially consists of three parts, the inhaling part, the holding of the breath, and then the exhaling part. The inhaling and exhaling are supposed to indicate the two primal sounds which are constant in Indian music, sa and pa. Shajja and Panchama. So fast forward to my graduate studies at IIT Madras. IIT Madras had the collaboration with Germany. And so probably we were among the first to get our hands on a book that has left a very deep imprint on me ever since. This was Viktor Frankl's book, which is about man's search for meaning. Published first in 1946. My friends, almost 75 years later, it is still listed as one of the top 10 books of all time ever written, and one of the top 100 books that everyone must read in their lifetime. So imagine the number of books that have been written on a variety of topics and subjects, and 75 years later on to be considered as a must read, it must be something. Now, Viktor Frankl was an Austrian neurologist and psychiatrist, and he was imprisoned during the Holocaust. And out of that experience, he wrote this book. How did he survive the Holocaust? Not by cursing the fate that fell on him, but instead turning it into love, turning it into kindness, kindness for the other inmates, compassion, empathy, understanding, imagining a world in which he would be a part of, just being grateful for the fact that he was still alive, never bothering what might happen to him the next moment or the next day or the next month. He has written about 39 books. I'll not go into all of them. But during his incarceration, he imagined, and you might find this really hard to even believe today, that once he got out, he would build a mansion. And he imagined it brick by brick, a brick of love, a brick of kindness, a brick of compassion, a brick of gratitude. And then he imagined how he would welcome people into his house, how everyone would be welcome, how they would be treated, how everyone would receive love, how they would sit down for dinner or lunch or breakfast and share whatever they had with a sense of gratitude. He imagined all of this. And once the war was over and he was free, a free person again, he went back into practice and he built that mansion of his, which he had imagined while he was incarcerated. This is probably the most profound example of someone in a very dire and difficult circumstance, overcoming those tremendous odds and turning it into something very positive. And more importantly, converting it into something very real. So this has led to two important constructs in recent times, and the relatively new field of positive psychology. And the other is, till that point of time, the two psychiatric interventions were those of Freud and Adler. Viktor Frankl's work led to the triad of psychotherapy, which today goes by the name of logotherapy. It's primarily one of converting everything into positive thoughts and positive feelings and ensuring that the outcomes are also positive. And even if they are not positive always, to treat them with equanimity. So what can we do? There could not have been a better time to discuss this very beautiful and very important topic as today, because the whole world is in the grip of an unseen virus, something so small that even under a very powerful microscope you cannot see it, but which has pretty much brought the world to a standstill. So what can we do? Practically, how can anyone, without any investment, without any gadgets, without anything at all, how can we practice mindfulness, living in the moment, savoring the moment, being grateful for whatever has come to us? What can we do? It's a simple 5-step process that I would advocate based on my experience and practice. The first one is, when as soon as you get up, start with a sense of purpose. Be grateful for the fact that we are still alive, and so it's a new day to look forward to. And so what is the purpose that I am going to serve today? So with that sense of purpose, we can move on, and then even in our breathing, we can start with a 2-minute deep breathing exercise, simply just observing how we breathe in air and breathe it out. Not just through the nostrils, but right down to the abdomen and the chest. Mindful eating, enjoying every morsel of food as a gift from nature or from some superior force, whichever you believe in. Even if you don't believe in anything, something to be grateful for. Millions are deprived of it every day, and we are fortunate to have that. So let's be grateful for that, each morsel of food. Can we savor it? Can we see what ingredients have gone into it? Then mindful pause every 30 minutes or every hour. Can we take a break and just move our hands, move our feet, move our body, move around, just take a walk within the house. And finally, in whatever we do, whether it's walking or cycling or a workout or anything, any other form of physical exercise that we want to indulge in, can we be aware of what we are doing? What parts of our body are getting affected? And how we can balance the positive and the negative in a way that we reach the state of stita prajnyatva or equanimity. So this is what I have learned from my reading of various materials and attending courses on the science of happiness at Stanford and so on. My 9 minutes or so I see are over. Sonia had very kindly sent us this gentle reminder that we need to take 8 to 10 minutes. Therefore, I'll stop here and I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have. As a token of gratitude for this opportunity that has been provided, here is a small gesture from me. I'll be happy to send 3 of the participants of this webinar this amazing book, Man's Search for Meaning. But I need your contact details. Sonia will decide who will get the books. It comes with no strings attached whatsoever. Entirely as a token of gratitude and appreciation for your interest in reading, interest in knowing things. So thank you very much for this opportunity once again, and over to you, Sonia.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for this very crisp talk. And I'm really sorry for keeping each one of you time bound. I understand that this topic cannot be talked about in just 8 minutes. And I know this coming from each participant, each guest speaker, that mindfulness pe 8 minute mein kaise baat kare. It's not an easy thing to do, but what to do? We just wanted to give a little flavor to the participants here that how fabulous this topic is. And thank you so much for kickstarting today's evening with such fabulous yet simplistic terms. Like I was writing down that how mindfulness is integral to our breathing, the inhalation and the exhalation, and how it is linked with simplistic things like gratitude, and then we can be more mindful. And the 5 tips that you have given on mindfulness is something which are I'm sure our participants have been quickly noting down. If not, don't worry, I have noted them down and I'm going to put them in the chat box for each one of you to take that as a key takeaway. And I cannot move on further without saying a big thank you to Dr. Krishna Venkatesh for being so humble and generous, for giving away those 3 books. Wow. That's like, thank you so much, sir. You know, in this format at CBL Book Talks, what we do is we have the guest speakers speak in. And towards the end, we'll open the platform for audience to share their reflections and ask questions to individual panel members or general questions also. So I request to the audience to please keep a note of your questions or keep a note of your reflections, if any, and we will take them towards the end of the session. Before I move on further, once again, a big thank you to Dr. Krishna Venkatesh for enlightening us and kickstarting this session on a wonderful note. Thank you so much, sir. Moving on to my next guest tonight, or today evening rather, is someone who's right here with us, Manika Sharma. Let me just tell you a little bit about Manika, because as I said, आज के हमारे सारे जो गेस्ट्स हैं वो बहुत सुपर अचीवर्स हैं और वो इतनी सारी चीजें अचीव कर चुके हैं लाइफ में कि इनजस्टिस होगा अगर मैं उनके बारे में कुछ भी बोलना मिस करूंगी. So Manika, my dear friends, is an entrepreneur. She's an educationist. She's a parenting coach. She's a curriculum designer. She's a meditation, yoga, and cognitive development trainer. And she's a corporate presenter. Oof. Manika, did I miss anything? If I did, my humble apology. Also, she's been involved with Indian and US education industry for more than 15 years. At present, she's here in Bangalore, very much in India. And she's a big fan of what you call, as parents or as adults, what you call as a holistic way of looking at growth and development. And when I was talking to her, she sounded like someone like, you can't just talk about physical fitness. You cannot just talk about mental fitness. You cannot just talk about emotional fitness. It has to be talked in tandem. It has to be talked in together. So that's where we struck the chord and we thought that, you know, who else than her to come on this platform and share her experience about how a few books have changed her life in terms of looking at mindfulness or practicing mindfulness in a holistic way. So over to you, Manika.
Thank you, Sonia. Thank you for that kind introduction. And it is indeed an honor to be part of this group of panelists. And thanks again for making me do this. And so today, for reference, in fact, the very first time when you asked me that to think of a book that had really transformed my own understanding on the topic of mind, the first book that came to me was Truth Eternal. So this is the book which I will be talking about today. So Truth Eternal is, really speaking, it is not just the content of the book that amazes me. The really amazing part of Truth Eternal is that it grows with you. The more you evolve with your understanding of the things around, the more the book's understanding also grows along with you. So really speaking, Truth Eternal was written by Ramchandra of Fatehgarh sometime around early 20th century. And originally the book was written in Urdu and Farsi. And it was in 1970s that the book was translated in English. And now it is part of Heartfulness Way series, which is available on Amazon also. And the book by itself talks about multiple aspects, but today we will be taking only one para that, in fact, I wanted to share with everybody that really struck a chord with me with the topic of mindfulness that I wanted to share with everyone today. So going a little bit behind to when my association with this particular book started, it was when I started exploring and I started researching as a parent various spaces of human development. And at that point of time, when I was researching on various fields, what I realized was that, really speaking, a century and a half where we have been placed as in the education space, as the research space also, there is a lot of research that has gone into the space of understanding the physical aspect of existence. When we talk about the biology, we talk about the physical laws of existence, the way the things around us functions. So there has been really an extensive research on the topic. Now, around the same time frame was the first time when I picked Truth Eternal in year 2006. And really speaking, I couldn't pass beyond the first page because it did not make any sense to me when I picked it up. And I put it on the side and I went on with my research. Now, as I moved along, I came to know that over the last two decades, what has really also seeped in is the research on the topic of mind itself. So there has been a very enhanced research which has gone into the field of understanding the functioning of mind. The topics like neuroplasticity or epigenetics or mindfulness as a practice itself has come up. Now, during that time frame, I again picked up Truth Eternal. Now, this was around 2013 when I picked up the book again. And this time I understood it. Not only I understood it, a little bit, I would say, because it keeps on growing. But really speaking, it also gave me the reason that I was not able to understand in the previous time when I picked it. So in this book, very beautifully, the author, what he has described to us is that as humans, we, like as I shared with you before also, and this is one of the places where the whole concept of holistic self came into the picture for me as well. So here in the book, the author does talk about us existing as humans at physical, mental, energy, and spiritual spaces. Now, the existence of us in all these spaces is always present. But what shifts is the focus of the mind. Depending on where you are focused, if you are focused on the physical self, your awareness of that physical self will be more. Your understanding of that physical self will be more. But if your mind thoughts are focused on the mental space or the mind space, it is going to nurture that particular space. So really speaking, at the very first thing, what we really need to observe is that where our day-to-day life focus is primarily on. So as I shared with my own experience, when first time I picked up the book, my focus was very much was on the physical understanding of how things understand. But whereas the book was coming from a space of giving me an understanding from a different level. And that was the reason that I was not able to connect to the book. But on the other hand, when second time I picked it up, I was able to understand it from a different perspective. And as I moved along the way, it gave me more perspective and clarity in the way as well. But it is not just the origin of the thought which is focused in the book. The second element which the author brings in is the idea of knowing something. So not the knowledge, but the idea of knowing something. You can be aware of something which is present around you, but that knowing can be your own self's knowing. It can come from your belief system. It can come from your environment. You can know something from any space, but it is not part of your knowledge, or it does not become part of you until and unless you have felt it, you have experienced it, you have really lived it. That is the reason that most of the time we get stuck at the point of knowing itself, and we don't even go to the next level of converting it into knowledge. And the third aspect of it, which comes into place, is the purpose, which was definitely something which we heard already into the picture. If there is no purpose to the knowledge that you have gained, then it is really not doing the full reason that we have got this beautiful mind with us. I would like to put it like this, that if this whole process of knowing, knowledge, and purpose is not put into the perspective, then it is like we do, all of us have a beautiful mind, but we have it as a monument. It is just with us. We look at it, we enjoy it, and we really feel very awesome with it. But until and unless it becomes a tool of transformation, it is not something that can serve the true purpose of its existence. And weaving this thought into your mindfulness practice, or when you are observing your space of thoughts coming into the picture, I would say there are two things that I love to share. One is the source of the thought. What is the source of the thought that is coming to you? And second, the flavor of your thoughts. So when we talk about the source of the thought, the source can be your belief system. Source can be your subconscious mind. Source can be your environment. It can even be your super consciousness. So what is the real source of your thoughts? You might become very aware of the kind of thoughts you are having, but what are the intricacies of those thoughts? What is the real flavor of those thoughts? Try to go deeper into that so that you can create something transformational for yourself. So, yeah. So that's what I'd like to share today, Tanya.
Let me unmute myself. Yeah. Manika, that was an interesting thought. And I was so engrossed in your what you were saying towards the end about the source and the flavor. These are two interesting terms that you're leaving us with. And it's a very smart way to leave the audience, because it's intriguing, and it's leaving the audience with the whole, the craving of, oh, she's finished. I was so engrossed and looking forward to keep hearing her, because she was talking about such interesting stuff that, knowing knowledge and purpose, and how beautifully you have woven these three things. And it reminded me of my very first class of mindfulness that, yes, it is so much about knowing the purpose. It is so much about being in that moment. It is so much about the power of now. And we all tend to forget that. And we all tend to enjoy a sort of multitasking. And we feel so proud of the fact that we can do 20 things physically, and at that same time, the 20 things mentally also running in our mind. Whereas when you start practicing a mindful life, and when you start actually questioning what you left us with, that what is the source of your thought and what is its flavor, that's when you start to practice what is called as mindful living.
I was trying my best to stay within the time frame.
Oh my God. I'm going to get a big bashing on this. So this 8 minutes and 10 minutes bashing is going to come from each guest today. But Mohit, can you come on the, can you please turn on your camera and take the bashing equally? because he is the one who always tells us, or tells whosoever the host is, boss, dekho 10 minutes se zyada bologe to meri audience bark jayegi. But
I have even left the time that we can chit chat.
But trust me, Mohit has an interesting plan for each one of us. Because there is something structured and there's something more elaborate that he's planning, I know. Mohit, you want to say something around that?
Feedback values, and to everyone who has joined in today, mindfulness at this point of time, and what Dr. Monica and Dr. Krishna just mentioned, and I'm sure Rajiv and Dr. Pankaj will also talk about it. And Sonia is a harbinger of that change, of bringing that mindfulness with all her talks and workshops that she is doing. We are looking forward to create a very interesting course in mindfulness, and I'm sure Sonia would definitely lead it for us to facilitate that. So that's where, you know, we will go beyond 8 minutes, and we'll have more interaction for, I guess, 80 minutes and more. Yeah. Yes. So that's the idea.
Yes, but that's the
thank you, Sonia.
That's the idea, that, you know, have a little flavor and understand that, yes, it really attracts me. Sometimes kya hota hai, you know, we really feel subconsciously that yes, it really, I'm very intrigued on what it is. But when you start listening to it, either you feel dejected that, oh no, this is not my cup of tea, or you feel very intrigued and even more attracted towards the whole concept of the product, as I would say, that I want to know more. I want to experience this product. I want to experience what is more in it for me. So keep looking out on the page or the web page of CBL, because soon enough, you know, we'll be posting about a very structured, longish program coming in, which will spread over a few weeks, so that, you know, you understand more about that. Now, coming back to what we are here for today, and I have my third speaker, and it gives me a lot of pleasure for two reasons. The next guest on the list is someone I really genuinely, what should I say, look up to, and bahut kuch seekha hai maine inse. Uska reason ye hai ki ye hamare professor the hamare institute mein jab hum padhte the, Institute of Management Technology mein, kafi saal pehle. Yes, our next guest on the panel is Dr. Pankaj Gupta, who used to be our professor, and he still teaches, but not in the same institute. He's moved to a different place. So it's a huge pleasure, sir, if you give me the permission to introduce you on this stage. And my dear friends, I told you that he's running fever. He's not well. सलमान खान का एक डायलॉग है जो वो कहता है अपनी पिक्चर्स में, जब मैंने एक बार कमिटमेंट कर दी तो मैं फिर खुद की भी नहीं सुनता. तो डॉक्टर गुप्ता भी कुछ उसी फिलॉसफी में बिलीव करते हैं. बट थैंक यू सो मच सर, जोक्स अपार्ट, थैंक यू सो मच फॉर कमिंग ओवर. despite you are unwell. A quick introduction, Dr. Pankaj Gupta is a global academic leader with a professional experience of more than 25 years. As a professor, as a researcher, a leader, an institution builder, and above all, a happiness practitioner. So, along with his core subjects on finance, accounting, and other subjects as curriculum subjects, he also teaches on self-awareness and happiness or mindful leadership. The list of accolades and the list of awards he has got is huge. So if I'll read one or two, pura injustice ho jayega. If I'll start to read all of them, I'll need another session with CBL. So, abhi usko main nahi pad rahi hu because he's got many achievements, many awards, many accolades. We will reserve that for our next session with him. But right now, without any further ado, over to you, sir. Sir, you'll have to unmute. You're on mute.
Am I audible?
Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay. Namaskar, Sonia ji. Rajiv ji, namaskar. Manika ji, Krishna ji, and Mohit ji, Ridhima ji, aap sabhi logon ko namaskar. Aur sare jo log upasthit hain, aap sabhi logon ko mera bahut bahut namaskar. Aur you know that I was little unwell, but you know I was doing meditation and I got recovered. And I would like to thank Sonia ji for this great platform. And I was also hearing Manika ji, who I missed. Krishna ji's presentation. These days, many people are talking about mindfulness. What is the real mindfulness? As I would like to, since I am currently with the ISMR University, which is the premier health management university in India and a collaborative partner with the Johns Hopkins. So, when we talk about health or swasth, then what is swasth? It is swa ni sthit. That is swasth. So, how you are swa ni sthit? And when you are not sthit in the swa, then you are aswasth. So, that again is a very deep meaning. And WHO has been earlier saying about the physical health, the mental health, and emotional health. Now they have added fourth dimension, that is a spiritual health. Do we all know that what spirituality is? I have been always a professor of finance and accounting, but there were certain situations in my life where, you know, I was just running after positions and money. And after that, there was some near death experience in my life and different other things. So I spend a lot of time in silence, also spending a lot of minutes in silence in the Himalayas, sometime on the beach. So getting close to nature and also connecting with my own self. I also had almost like 3.5 million connections on the LinkedIn and all that. And but I had no connection with myself. So after this whole journey of inner journey started, then I realized, you know, what was the great treasure within me, which I was missing and I was trying to search everywhere. So, since Sonia ji said that I have to share from a book, so I'll be sharing from this book. That is, can you see? That is Seven Spiritual Laws of Success by Deepak Chopra. It is such a profound book. I'd like to say that this book was given to me by my mentor, Mr. Sharad Kumar, for whom I always have great regard and respect, and so with Rajiv Karwalji, a great mentor and friend, and supported IMT and other, all of us so much. So when he gave this book, initially I thought it is just like another book. And for 1 year I did not even touch this book. But later on when I started reading this book, I've read it many times, and believe me that whenever I read this book, something new opens up. So it would not be possible for me, given the time of 10 minutes, to share the whole wisdom out of this book. This book talks about different laws. That is, one is a law of pure potentiality. Then there is a law of giving. Then law of karma, or the cause and effect. Then law of least effort. then law of intention and desire, then law of detachment, and finally the law of dharma or the purpose in life. Maybe initial two, I'd like to take a little bit, or maybe just a summary of different laws. Question is that what we think we are. Sometimes we feel that, okay, we are this, we are that. I am good enough or not so good enough. In order to be really good enough, then I need to have maybe $1 billion, maybe so many great houses or cars, big bank balance and so on. But we have always seen that whenever we have these things, they give only a temporary sense of some satisfaction, but again there is a need for bigger toys, and that list goes on and on. What people say is like, oh, 99 ke phir mein pad gaye, 1.99 billion, now you need 2 billion, and then you keep, you know, going on and on. So the question is, what is real, and is there any way in which, you know, somebody can have the happiness? And so first and most important is the law of core potentiality. So what do we think who we are? So once you feel that, okay, I am this limited person, I have to just compete, the world is a very dangerous place to live. So all the time I'll be on the guard, I will always say that, okay, let people not take advantage of me. And many such kind of thoughts will always be coming to me. And therefore, different kind of directions, as may be shared by the other people whom we admire, or maybe who are looking like a more worldly wise, we will listen to them and say, okay, this is the way, okay, I'll also go this way. So therefore, there is hardly a time. And you know what we say, these kind of way we are running here and there, that is what we say, that you are running either in abhav or prabhav. That means either you have a sense of deprivation within you, and which you feel that by this and this thing, by getting these toys, you'll be good enough. Or prabhav means somebody else's influence. But then we do not talk about the swabhav. Swabhav and swadharma. So how this swabhav is coming is to know and understand that what exactly you are meant for. You know, there people say that, okay, there's a purpose of life. There are a lot of people who will give guidance about the purpose of life, but everyone has to discover their own path. So this book also says that everyone is like a seed of possibility, and that seed of possibility has to discover for himself or herself the right kind of soil, the right kind of environment, the right nurturing. And when the seed is there, it will transform into its own bliss, its own flower, fruits, each and everything will come. But again, there is a system that people will say that this is not good enough, that is not good enough. So in this way, the whole realization of self, which is driven more externally, and that is giving so much of pain and problem to most of the people. So therefore, it is very, very important for us to go for the inner journey. So what the author says, that you must find time for silence and contemplation. And the author says that minimum half an hour time you should reserve for yourself in the morning and also in the evening. Like Manika ji is a heartfulness preceptor, so am I. So we start our day with meditation, and after that in the evening also we do the cleaning. Cleaning means whatever are the heaviness, sanskara, they have accumulated during the day, you clean it up, and then you again become like a baby or a bud of a rose. So you are living a natural life. You are, you know, not bothered as to what is going to happen tomorrow. There was a recent study done by the Harvard School of Public Health. They said the people are living in the moment hardly 18%. That means where they are living, 82%. That is only either the regret of the past or anxieties of the future. So that means the 82% of your life you are just wasting. So maybe some people will agree with me that many people are not living in 18% time in the present. So mindfulness is nothing but, you know, accepting the way the things are and also doing the best of the karma, whatever you can. And the second law, what author says about the law of giving, all the time we are there just to acquire. And hardly there is time to enjoy what we have already acquired. So even in Bible says that it is in the giving that we receive. And if you look at our, the devtas, why they are called as devta? To give deity. Otherwise, they wo lete hote, unka naam hota levta. So it is always, what say that the kind of happiness and bliss you get is not in acquiring, not getting resources for your own self, but being a good conduct, how it is happening. You know, what the Sufism says is like a raza me raji. Jo praapt hai, wo paryapt hai. Rather than all the time having a, all the time this thing, oh, this is not good enough. If I get this, then only I'll be happy. So in this way, you are just being cruel to your own life. So the concept of self, what also author says, that there is a seed of divinity in each one of us. But that is hardly manifested because we are not able to see that. So only by when we are in silence, when we have this practice of reflecting and being with ourself for some time, then we see that our inner self will start talking to us. And that will be the right way which will guide you to the right direction. So we will be moving away from going in any wrong direction with a restless mind all the time. From that domain we'll go to right direction, which is based on my swabhava and swadharma, and with a restful mind, which is at rest. And so therefore the silence, meditation, mindfulness, non-judgment, these are the very important things. And also yoga, what is yoga? Yoga means the union, connecting you with your own self. It is not only those hatha yoga, those asanas. They are only part of the yoga. So, and also when you're putting any intention into picture, it is like, you know, when you go to a still pond and there you put one pebble, you know, it is just creating big ripples. But if it is already a disturbed kind of, you know, if you go throw that into an ocean, where there's already so many waves are coming, it will not create any impact. So when your mind is quiet, it is like a still lake, and then you put one pebble, it is going to manifest. But many times what happens that we are not able to really believe that whatever our intent is really going to happen. So, maybe, do I have still more time, Sonia ji, or?
I said, sure, sir, you can take another 2.5 minutes for sure.
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Well, I thought, you know, if we split the time.
No, please.
Okay. So it is very, very important that during our lifetime, we should know what is real and what is unreal. When, you know, since I'm heading a university and I've been in many academic institutions, I have seen that there is too much focus on the avidya portion. Avidya means, you know, what is real, what is important today may not be tomorrow. Like today you talk about AI, big data, blockchain. These are very important today, but they may not be hot tomorrow. But while the vidya is to connect you who you are, what is the seed of possibility you have? What is your passion? What is your ability? And what is your faith? What I created the model known as Aruchi, Yogyata or Vishwas. That is how you have your swabhava, and from swabhava to swadharma. And when you're doing that, then there's no tension. Things will be easy. And if you feel that something you really enjoy doing, then there is no need for any hard work. Because whatever you do, you enjoy. And with that, we do that with passion and with love and with total ownership. Then wherever you are supposed to go, you will go there. That is what the author says, the law of least efforts. That where you need not to bother, things will happen. In the same way, it talks about the law of abundance. If you feel, oh, I may get sick, I may be run out of money. It is what you are saying. The moment you say, many, many years back when I started my career, then I had some problem of money. Then one of my mentor, who is no more in this world, he told me that if you give an auto suggestion, that God is my immediate and endless source of supply. Therefore, I'm fearless in letting money go. And he said, whenever you have less money, you give it to somebody, even if you don't have anything. And then you see the magic. I have tried it many times. So the moment you are very comfortable, and also you know that whether you talk about money or position or power, we all are very, very subjective. So your self-worth is not connected to this. Because if position is there, then you say, oh, you are this, you are president. But what you are inside, I think that is what has to be respected. And that also he says the living as per the Swadharma. So I just thought to share these thoughts and I'll be happy to chip it again. So thank you again, Sonia ji. Namaskar. Thank you all.
Well, thank you so much, sir, for being here with us. And despite that, you know, you're unwell, but it's a pleasure. And I am so overwhelmed with your gesture. And thank you so much for bringing us, or in fact, introducing the something which is practically synonym to what mindfulness is: accepting the way we are, being non-judgmental. These words and these terms go hand in hand with how we use mindfulness in our teachings these days, that, you know, your heart should be full of abundance. In fact, I'll just take this minute, this moment to narrate a quick story. Being a storyteller, wo kahanikar ko kahani sunane ka mauka chahiye. To ek quick, sir ne jo story sunai hai ye kitab mein se, I'm going to relate it to a very old story where there was this ancient Greek man called Diogenes. He was a very wise man, and a lot of people would come to him to meet him. And once Alexander the Great came to meet him. And at that time, Diogenes was enjoying his sunlight. And Alexander the Great came and stood right in front of him, obstructing the sunlight, and looked at Diogenes and said, I have heard a great deal about you. Is there anything I can do for you? And Diogenes looked at him like this, head to toe, and said, well, if you can just excuse me, you're blocking my sunlight. And at that moment, Alexander felt like a beggar. And he immediately left from that place. He reached back his so-called castle or whatever, and he called everybody. And he said, if I were not Alexander the Great, I would want to be Diogenes. This short story but just tells us that there are two type of people. One, like Alexander the Great, who are very, very full, who look very full from outside, but they're very empty from inside. And second is the Diogenes type, who might look empty from outside, but as Dr. Gupta said, that their heart is full of one thing, and that is abundance. The heart is full of sense of abundance and sense of gratitude. Like Dr. Krishna also mentioned these words in his thing. So, you know, when we as practitioners of mindful living talk in any forum, you will hear words which are repetitive, which look synonyms to each other, because that is what mindful living is, that being in the present, being in the moment, be non-judgmental, have a sense of gratitude, have a heart full of abundance. So thank you so much, Dr. Pankaj Gupta, once again. I have to, before going to the next guest, I have to mention about the books our guests have used, because I can see that some people missed. So Dr. Krishna Venkatesh referred to a book by Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning. Manika talked about from a book titled Truth Eternal, by Ramchandra of Fategar. Dr. Pankaj Gupta talked about the 7 spiritual laws of success by Deepak Chopra. Yes, so I hope our audience and participants have taken a note of that. Okay, now time to go to the next panelist. And it's such an immense pleasure. Khushi bahut hai mujhe apne baaki speakers ke saath bhi, Dr. Krishna Venkatesh, Manika, no offense, but the next speaker who we have is a fellow IMTN. Rajiv, if I can say that. But he's a super, super, super senior, a thorough professional and a leader I have always, always looked upon. Almost like a junior, like a person studying from the same institute, sneaking through his articles and looking at his speeches, his talks, his sessions. Practically lived on his research papers because of also especially for me, because of the same interest, he's spent all his time in durables. I started my career with FMCG, moved on to durable. So I always looked upon, okay, if he was in this situation, what would he do? And then look at his papers and all. But meri bug bug chalti rahegi, because I'm a big fan of Rajiv. But let me just professionally and officially introduce him here. Rajiv Karwal is the founder chairman of Milagro Robots, India's number one consumer and commercial service robots. He is known to be a renowned management thinker. He spent a lot of time with LG, Philips, Electrolux, Reliance. He has also authored a book in 2008 titled Corporate Blogging in India. Also, let me now, I'll have to refer to the notes. He's won an award as the most powerful CEOs in year 2004. In 2002, he was rated as the top 25 hot young rising stars. Hot young rising stars, Rajiv. That's very impressive. Okay. He's also achieved and won India's Young Manager Trophy by CII. He's also achieved awards as Marketing Person of the Year and International Leadership Award from Grand Prix Championship. Yes, I haven't missed on the main, and there are sub-main accolades also. Okay. Over to you, Rajiv. He's going to talk about his journey, his experience of mindful living. And the book he's going to refer to is Jonathan Livingstone Seagull. Is that so, Rajiv? So without further delay, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonia. It was a wonderful introduction. Thank you, Dr. Pankaj, for mentioning me, remembering me. Thank you, Dr. Manika, Dr. Krishna, Mohit, Riddhima, and everyone for coming here. When Sonia was describing, you know, how she kind of knew of me or knew me, I immediately understood at that point in time that the reason for, you know, me being the last speaker is because the other three are doctors and I am the patient. I mean, the patient one. So that was a wonderful way of, kind of ordering the speaking sessions. It is something of a topic which has been always very dear to me. I've always felt that, and there was a time when I kind of also felt that I am a superman and I can multitask a lot of things. And, slowly I realized that I may feel that I am able to do multiple things, but after a couple of days, one kind of forgets what was the topic, what was the decision, and then you can have a lot of control mechanisms, etc. But you are never there, and especially when you are running an organization or when you are at decision-making, positions, you have to be into that thing which you are deciding or you are contemplating at that point in time. Very early on in my life, actually, I found that, if you internalize, you never have to memorize. Even when I used to prepare for my exams, I did the, study of the entire, subject. And then I never used to pick and choose what to revise again. I used to again start from the start, okay, if I have missed out, in terms of understanding something, because once you have understood a particular subject, then you don't have to actually again go back and refer, because it has been internalized in you. And Saraswati will come to your, tongue and speak. You will not have to kind of refer to anything. But today, when we are talking about Jonathan Livingstone Seagull, it is one book which has kind of changed my entire life. It was way back in 1982, in fact, when I was, you know, when I had actually given a lot of examinations for joining an MBA course, and I had, you know, gone to my graduate college to take some certificate. I met with an accident, and then I was on the bed for almost 3 or 4 months. All the opportunities just, you know, went by. And it was a very sad period, you know, to start off initially for me. And I felt that I'll be left behind and everybody will, you know, move ahead. And I used to worry a lot. And at that point in time, somebody gave me this book, Jonathan Livingston Seagull. And from there on, I have been a kind of a worshipper of this book. In fact, so much so that in our you know, current organization, we have named two robots Seagull. So one is a floor cleaning robot and one is a window cleaning robot. And you know, so that is the amount of identification I have with this book. But I know that you know, when we talk like this, after some time, we kind of tend to let our mind wander. So today what I'll do is I'll actually use a few slides and I will use certain quotes from the book itself, and I'll run through them very quickly, and because thereafter we can, you know, if we have some time, we can always have a discussion on some of those. And I'll use color in these slides, I'll use some movement in these slides, so that as many senses as possible one can engage and make you mindful that there is a presentation which is going on. So let me just use the share screen and is my screen visible to everyone? Is my screen visible to everyone?
Yes.
Okay. So let's talk about Jonathan Livingston Seagull. It's a story of the real seagull who lives within us all. Most seagulls don't bother to learn more than the simplest facts of life, of flight, how to get from the shore to food and back again. For most gulls, it is not flying that matters, but eating. But for this gull, it was not eating that mattered, but flight. More than anything else, Jonathan loved to fly. And when we are talking about Jonathan Livingston Seagull, think of a seagull. Imagine yourself as if you are that seagull and travel these few slides as if you are the seagull, you are the person, you are the hero of this story. He found quickly that it was this urge to do something different which made him unpopular with other normal eating girls. He spent whole day alone making hundreds of low and slow glides, experimenting. There was so much and so much to learn. It became a routine all for him to set off all by himself, far out at sea, hungry, happy, learning. He was hungry yet happy. He was happy yet learning. And in many ways, when we think of these three words, they can be contradictory, they can be conflicting with each other. But since it was his being, he was hungry, he had the passion, he was into it, he was happy, he was happily learning. The subject was speed. He defined it as speed. And in a week's practice, he learned more about speed than the fastest girl alive. Nobody could match him amongst his flock. One day, when he returned, all the girls were waiting. Jonathan Seagull, stand to the center. Said the elder, stand to the center only meant great shame or great honor. He thought, they saw the breakthrough. He thought to himself, I want no honors. I have no wish to be the leader. I want only to share what I have found, to show these horizons out ahead for all of us. he stepped forward. Jonathan Siegel, said the elder, stand to the center for shame in the sight of your fellow girls. It felt like being hit with a board. His knees went weak. His feathers sagged. There was roaring in his ears. Centered for shame? Impossible. The breakthrough? They can't understand? They're wrong. They're wrong. He felt broken. He felt shocked. His heart was crying. To be centered for shame meant that he would be an outcast of the girls' society, banished to a solitary life on the far cliffs. For doing what? For trying to do something which was different, which probably was taking him towards self-actualization. The flock thought that one day he shall learn that irresponsibility does not pay. Life is known and yet unknowable, except that we are put into this world to eat, to stay alive as long as we possibly can. Some of us who are there into the session this long, think of yourself. Think of certain situations in your own life. Think of certain situations where people who are elder, you know, look at your children, children in your family, people who want to do different, people who don't want to join their family businesses, want to do something else. Think of them and relate. John spent the rest of his days alone. His sorrow was not of solitude, but that the girls refused to open their eyes and see. He continued his practice though. He thought he had perfected the art of flying. What he had once hoped for the flock, he had now gained for himself. He was practicing and achieving that speed. You know, he could soar very high. He could come down, dive, you know, at a great speed. He could turn back. So he was really gaining a lot. He was not sorry for the price he had to pay. One evening, however, while gliding, two other girls appeared and John challenged them to compete. He lost. He was sad. He was beaten. He was isolated, but he was still positive. He introspected and went to the two girls to learn when one school is over, it is time for another. We have come to take you higher, they said. In the new world, he found that with the new wings and body though, the flying was easier. But there were other girls who were still better than him, much, much better. There was so much to learn in this place as there was in the life behind him, and that it takes a thousand lives for the perfection in each world. But he had achieved it in one lifetime. He was there. There were girls who had traveled for thousands of years and thousands of lives to be there. One day, while enjoying the flight, he encountered a lonely elder girl who taught him, heaven is no place, but it is just being perfect. And touching heaven is like touching the perfect speed. He thought, he worked on perfection, but as he was working on that perfection, the desire to return to his own flock was growing. His heart was talking about the family he left behind. Just imagine as if we have gone abroad, or some of the people who have gone in pursuit of, you know, their careers, and then they look back and they say, you know, this is my gaon. Look at the, you know, Me Raksam movie which Shabana Azmi made, and then she took this girl from Mijwan, you know, and she dedicated that film to her father. It is the same thing. While returning, John meets a young Siegel, an outcast like him, and takes him for a student. So sometimes we feel that, okay, we are the first ones. There were many before. There'll be many after. But there has to be a sense of gratitude. There has to be a sense of giving back. By the end of 3 months, John had 4 other students, all outcasts, who enjoyed high performance but did not understand their own real motive behind it. They were just made like that. They wanted to experiment. They wanted to really push the boundaries of what their bodies could take. After a month, John decided that the time had come for them to return to the flock's council beach. On getting identified as the outcasts, a word was spread across to ignore them or themselves become outcast. John held practice sessions every day, and soon admiration for their flying skills spread. Gradually, curious girls started attending John's lessons in the dark, not wishing to see or get seen. A month after the return, the first girl crossed the line and joined John during the daytime, making himself the eighth student. This, with time, went many folds, bringing the entire flock with him. Together, the flock could develop the skills to fish in the water like a fish and soar like an eagle in the high sky. No flock could compete with them now. The understanding of their own capabilities and between one another was complete now. With perfection, they could experience heaven. Heaven, now let's talk about this. It is not a place and it is not a time. Heaven is being perfect. And perfection is not about flying 1,000 miles an hour or a million or flying at the speed of light, because any number is a limit. And perfection doesn't have limits. Perfect speed, my child, is just being there. This was the mantra which the older girl had given to Jonathan. This story actually was the third part. It was in three parts. In those three parts, Richard Batch, he never revealed that there was a fourth part which was also to come. In 2012, the writer of this story actually had a near-death experience. He was also a pilot. This book and its name also was after another co-pilot who was a test pilot. And he actually died, and it was in his memory that Richard actually had written this story. He went to many publishers who had refused, and he was ultimately taken up by Macmillan, who paid him about $2,000. But when in 2000, and this was 1969. So when in 2012, Richard had this near-death experience, he said, let me complete the fourth part, which was half written before something really happens. And he wrote that story, the last portion, where it is about 100, 150 years after, you know, the earlier version or earlier three episodes. And he starts about this flock, which has tremendous respect for Jonathan. But they are not experimenting like Jonathan. They respect Jonathan. They have a lot of rituals in their flock. And yet, nobody is allowed to go outside of the rules and rituals without real understanding, which the flock now has. Look at or relate to it something like, say, a Buddhism or something like Christianity or any religion, Hinduism or, you know, Islam. Look at it like this. And then suddenly in that story or the last portion, he, you know, there's a girl he talks about, I'm forgetting his name. And then this girl says, you know, all this is meaningless. I go to someone, ask for the meaning. Nobody's able to give me this meaning. Nobody's able to explain to me why should I practice this ritual. And then he says, life is worthless. For Jonathan, it started with, I don't want to have a life which is just, you know, eating, doing something, eating, sleeping, like that. And for this guy, he said, you know, they are locking me up. I'm not able to do anything. I want to understand the reason. And then he says, okay, let me just go higher and let me finish off my life. And this girl goes extremely high. And, you know, like Jonathan used to practice, this guy goes up and he dives and is, you know, diving at almost 190 miles per hour. And he would actually crash into the sea because he has not practiced how to turn, you know, which Jonathan had perfected. You know, it is, perfection is not about speed. Perfection is about just making that minor change, just being there. You know, it is not about speed. You need to know what is the perfect speed. And this, another girl appears almost like a ball of light with this girl who is committing suicide. And this girl who is committing suicide looks at this another seagull and says, who are you? I have never seen you before. And this seagull says, that you can call me John. I was always there watching, but I'm so glad that finally somebody took this thing to break free again. I never wanted people to respect me. I never wanted people to tie up the people, you know, behind me. The entire flock moved towards us or towards, you know, what I showed them. But I wanted people to experiment. I wanted people to adjust, to be in whatever they are doing. And, you know, that is where the story ends. So this book is all about being there, being mindful of what you want to do, what you can achieve. And that is how, you know, we raise the barrier. That is how we, you know, break the boundaries which sometimes are imposed on us by ourselves, society, real or imagined, issues which we might just say that, okay, I can't do it. But there is nothing which you can't achieve. And that will happen only when we are into something at that very moment. Because the moment which passes will never come back. This is the most precious thing which we have. And that is where we must give our whole heart to whatever we are doing. Thank you.
Wow, that's a fabulous story. And thank you so much for relating it and giving us that little thing of, you know, think about, you know, you or fit yourself into that seagull's role. It really also makes as an audience to understand the story more. And I think the biggest takeaway from your story, Rajiv, is that perfection is not about anything else, but about being there. So yeah. The author has very, very beautifully woven that whole concept of the vast concept of mindfulness in just one sentence, that perfection is about being there. And once again, as I've been reiterating about every speaker, that this story also talked about self-actualization, internalization, and, you know, being in that moment and enjoying that moment, being a part of that particular moment. So thank you so much, Rajiv, for this wonderful and very simplistic story, and it making it even more easier to understand this so-called difficult concept of people feel that, oh, it's very complicated, mindfulness. All right. So Mohit, I think it's time for our speakers to take a little rest and pause while we can open the mic for questions. I can see a couple of questions already being there in the chat window.
I'll do that. Thank you very much all four of you, and a special thanks to you, Sonia, for doing it every time with so much of perfection and like a seagull, I must say, right? And I will take it from the back. And what Mr. Garwal just mentioned, I recently watched a movie which is Free Fall, Flight 174. I've been known for what I read, but many a times I see as well. And it's a fascinating book, which actually emphasizes back on what Stephen Covey mentioned in one of his books. How will you treat someone knowing that you're meeting them for the last time in your life? That changes the entire perspective. And you just mentioned about the free fall or the flight that Jonathan and the and the relationship to that. And I think that's the purpose where we should be more humble, as much as humility possible, and all five of you. I'm really thankful for that, for managing time as well. And believe me, I never put the gun on anyone's head. But it was so engrossing to listen to all of you. I would now open the mic for Varun. He is our one of the members of City Book Leaders, an avid learner. Himself loves to read as much as possible. And I think his question is also related to reading. I will open the mic for Varun. Ridhima, if you can do that. And then our next question would be to Nipun, who's here from Bangalore. Varun, you may please ask him.
Yeah, thanks, Mohit. My question may sound very basic, but I wanted to ask that when you are working, obviously in your academic life, in your student life, when you are the 100% owner of your time, you can read as much as you want besides your academics. But once you start working, how do you create time to read as much as you want?
By when reading CVL every time.
Mohit. Okay, this question is for any particular panelist, or is it for anybody? Is it
anyone who choose to answer? Rajiv,
Dr. Krishna. Over to you. Yes, Rajiv. Yes.
I'll answer. See, what I do is that I try to keep a tab on what am I spending time on, and the moment I feel that there is something really important which I need to invest time on, then I kind of again prioritize and take out, the less productive or, something which I do, which is not really adding much value to me. But I also want to tell you that I kind of use the time very effectively. So, while shaving, I would be watching something, which is something very dear to me. And I don't, it's not about fiction or movies or anything of that sort, something which I have passion for. Even in the car, you can be listening. There are, it is not, if you can't read, you can listen, right? And just before you sleep, if you have a habit of reading a couple of pages, if you are very, very busy, and there is time, it is, sometimes we just feel that there is not enough time, but if you really prioritize, then you can find time for something which is dear to you. That is how I do.
Thank you.
Dr. Krishna, would you like to say something on how do you find time to read? You have to unmute yourself, sir. You're muted.
Apologies. There's only one resource in this universe that's given equally to each one of us. That is time. So at midnight every day, we are credited with 86,400 seconds. And with every passing second, it goes down till it reaches zero the next day. And the beauty of nature is that you again get 86,400 seconds as long as we live. However, the flip side of this is that you cannot carry it forward. You cannot say, I didn't use half the time yesterday, therefore I'm going to use it today. You cannot do that. It's not an inventory. So the challenge for each one of us is, how do we make use of the same time that is available to everyone in a better manner? So if you have the mind, you can find the time. It's simple. That's why I have absolutely no shame in admitting that even today I am a student. I read at least 2 hours every day. On average, I read at least 50 books in a year. So, if I can do in the twilight of life, I have just completed recording 4 online courses for universities in the US. during this lockdown period. So it's a question of being passionate about what you want to do. Then you can find the time.
Dr. Pankaj Gupta has something to say and to add. Yes, sir.
Sunil ji, and I think there was a question by Varun. I believe that there is enough time for everything to everyone. It is just that, you know, where your priority lies, you will definitely get time. So if you're not able to find time for something, that simply means that that item is not priority for you. I would like to say it in a very plain and simple way. So then we can say that I don't get time to read books. So that means book is simply not you're passionate about. Maybe something else. And also, I'd like to recommend, I very much like the idea of Rajiv ji, that how he is doing multitasking. But reclaiming your own life, you know, that, you know, you become the centerpiece. You are the most important thing in your life. So maybe you create, you know, like you're managing a business on a balanced scorecard model. You know, there is a time for office, there is time for everything. But we must create 10 to 15% time like a white canvas, where, you know, we can live and we can do anything. Like I saw in the people in the US and other places that, you know, their whole calendar is booked. There is hardly any time for any experimentation or living the way they would like to live. So reclaiming the life and not being too much bothered about, you know, even if I don't get one more achievement, कहते ना बंदा भी की फर्क पैंदा अपना आगे बढ़ो जी मे बी इफ समथिंग यू मिस यू जस्ट एंजॉय ऑन अ बीच और गो ऑन अ हॉलीडे बी इन माउंटेन्स हु नोज व्हाट विल ओपन अप फॉर यू सो यू नो व्हाटएवर वे द रूटीन इज रनिंग इट इज फाइन बट यू हैव द टोटल फ्रीडम एंड पावर टू ब्रेक दैट रूटीन लेट्स आई लाइक टू ऐड थैंक यू
I'll just like to share my experience with Varun because it is completely aligned to what he was saying. So when I became a trainer of meditation trainer for heartfulness, I was kind of thinking about this whole time thing, that how do you take out time for, you know, I was thinking on the same line, I don't have time. But then I realized that when we were in college at that point of time, my mom would tell us, you know, why don't you do this thing or the other. And we would say, oh, we have exam, we don't have time. Then I got married, I did my master's. So I was handling the house and I was studying. So the things kept adding. Finally, I reached a point where I was running a corporate, I was creating the curriculums, I was doing my own practice of meditation, had two children, managing the house and everything. And that day it occurred to me, what was I doing at the time when we were studying? It was only one thing, but still I was saying that I don't have time. But now I was managing so many aspects of my life and they were all happening. So very much what Dr. Pankaj said, that, you know, when things are really important for you, they start happening automatically. But when we are trying to find time for something, that means that it is not really a priority. Because something is a priority, it will automatically fit into the whole sequence. That is a flow that is automatically going to happen for you. And one thing also I'd like to add is that many a times what we tend to forget is that, yes, we have 24 hours, but we have 7 days. So you need to also master the art of timing yourself. Something might not need your attention every single day. You can spread it through. So learn the art of time management as well, so that you can increase your productivity when you are just started, you know, working on this time management thing. So, yeah, over to you.
Our next question comes from Wing Commander Ashok Dua. He's part of the Jal Vayu Community Center Book Club. Commander Dua, if you're there.
Yeah, I'm there. Okay. At the outset, I would like to congratulate City Book leaders for this session, wonderfully hosted by Sonia. And all the four speakers were excellent. I could relate to all of them, but having read two of the books, one that Viktor Frankl's man's search for meaning, and the other one, seven spiritual laws of Deepak Chopra. I still remember Viktor Frankl's words, which were quoted by Stephen Covey in his book, Seven Habits. He says, between stimulus and response, there is a space. And in that space lies our freedom and power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and freedom. So the point here is the response, the action, the behavior behind which there is a thought. Now, Manika Sharma, ma'am, came out with her final words were source of thoughts and flavor of thoughts. Now, we observe thoughts. We are not thoughts. Thoughts occur to us. Having said that, the source of the thoughts is a desire. Where is the desire coming from? Whether it is coming from your sensations. By sensation, what I mean is that it is coming through your panchindriyas, or it is coming from the past conditioning or preconditioning. Like we get conditioned during our childhood, we carry certain beliefs which may be right or which may not be right. And third source is our understanding, our right understanding, that if it is coming from that, we have what I call it, or what my guru called it, natural acceptance. If you have within you natural acceptance or sahaj svikriti, whatever the thought that you are analyzing to arrive at the decision that you are making based on which you will act. So the point that I am asking Madam Manika Sharma is whether my understanding of flavor and source is correct, or you have a different understanding of it. That's what I would like to know from Manika. Thank you.
Thank you, Ashokji, for asking that. No, you have completely put it beautifully. And I think during that time frame only, you have just reworded the same, what I was saying, where we were talking about the belief system, as I said, is exactly what gets framed out in us as children. So when we are around our parents and everybody, that is what I termed as belief system. And when we are talking about the super consciousness, is exactly what you mentioned, as your Guruji also talked about. Or super consciousness can be something termed as coming from the source, or something that is coming from a, you know, something which is very deep rooted into all of us. And we are able to listen to it, but because we are not attuned to listen to it, we ignore it. So many a times what happens is that during that pause, as rightly mentioned, that comes in the middle, that is a pause which really designs the whole destiny for us and the actions we take. So I was exactly talking about the same thing when I was talking about the element of source, that where is this source, the thought source that you are reacting to, is coming from? Is it just your belief system playing something because of your experience of the life? Or is it something higher that is trying to tell you something? So it was exactly that.
Thank you, Kumara Dua. I would now, Sonia, if you say, we can take the last question.
Nipun was about to ask.
Yeah, Nipun, we can take the last question by
Thanks, Mohit. Yeah. Thanks, Sonia.
One second. Sorry, Nipun. Mohit, if there are any more questions in the chat, maybe we can just reply to them over the email.
We can send them through email.
We can address them through email. Yes. Go ahead, Nipun. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks, Sonia. My question is for Mr. Rajiv. Does the concept of mindfulness also applies to organizations? Why I'm asking is, we have always read about core competence, focus, etc., right? So the story of Steve Jobs, who removed all the non-core activities from Apple when he came, and we see where Apple is, and right? But on the other hand, there's a guy called Musk who is almost present everywhere in this world, right? From rockets to electric cars to now the latest is chip in the brain. And as Mr. Krishna rightly said, time is a resource and it's limited. I'm sure it holds true for organizations, focus and money also. So I repeat the question, does the concept of mindfulness also apply to organizations?
See, you have kind of taken, something which an individual must practice to an organization, right? And, the smallest unit around you is your family, right? So if you were to try and practice mindfulness in your family and together, how would you do it, right? You would first probably, go through some sessions to understand, align yourself about what you're trying to do. Maybe you will go through some meditation together, and even then when you're doing those sessions together, at the end of those sessions, somebody will say, yes, I was able to concentrate. Somebody will say, no, I wasn't able to concentrate. My mind kept on wandering here, there, So what happens is that when you want to try this concept in a larger group or an organization, you ultimately, go back to the vision, mission, values, culture. And if there are so many people across, if it's a small organization, it is still easier. But even when we say easy, the degree is extremely, difficulty is extremely high compared to an individual. Because in an individual, you still have so many things under your control. And if you really focus and are at it, you can master yourself. It is also not easy, but you can still, you have things under your control. But in an organization, you really have to align themselves to a certain way of thinking and doing. So when you talk about values of the founder, which are directing an organization, right, then that results into the culture. But those values, if they are only talked about and they are not walked about, because it is always good to talk about good values. A lot of us think good about ourselves because we can think good. But who are the people who are really good? Are those who are able to put those good words into practice. Same way, a lot of people talk about a lot of goals. This is my vision. This is our organization's vision. This is our organization's mission. These are our long-term goals. These are our short-term goals. But how many of us actually, feel that we identify? Our bosses may be talking about something, but the bosses themselves or their immediate subordinates or the people down the line may be doing exactly the opposite. And so it is difficult, but the key is shared learning. The key is, sharing the same thing in multiple ways and saying, okay, now together with cohesion, we can work together. So look to that story which we were talking about, Jonathan Livingston Seagull, and how when he comes back, he takes four people as disciples and then slowly the entire flock comes to this side and then they are kind of realizing that what they can achieve together, right? So it is possible, but it is quite difficult in today's world where there are a lot of pulls and pushes and pressures and short-term gains, which one, gets affected by, even the leaders get affected by that. So while there are things which are right for the nation, they may be actually ending up doing many things which are just to win elections. And I'm not talking about any government. It is, Indian government or anything or Indian politicians. It is the world over. So look at it that way. So from organization, you can talk about the society, the state, the nation, the universe, and that is how things happen. It is possible, but difficult. You require really good role models to be able to, achieve that kind of a thing.
Thanks, Mr. Raji. Thanks for that.
I think Dr. Pankaj Gupta
wants to just add on.
I think Rajiv ji has already said whatever was the correct answer and the whole perspective he has very beautifully shared. I would just like to share my experience of doing these practices in two organizations. One was the OP Jindal Global University and another was the IHMR University. So we created a system, you know, where we used to have in the morning the starting the laughter yoga and then doing a meditation together. And also in the evening doing the cleaning session together, so that whatever sanskaras are there, let them go away. And in the during the course of discussion, suppose I spoke something harsh to somebody, and you know it is time for you to clean it up, so that you are free and also the other person is also free, and not spoiling, you know, somebody's home life. And also with the concept, if you are living mindfully, you may not be sure whether you are alive tomorrow or that person is alive tomorrow. So whatever you have to do today. But again, there would be different kind of people. You know, there are people who may have a system that, okay, if somebody does something, you please note it down, then give them 2-3 warning and, you know, find for appropriate moment, you know, to fix that person. So those kind of leaders are also there. But in that way, the authenticity in the leadership may not come. And also people may respect you for fear and, you know, what you can say, the formal authority. What some bosses say, my way or highway. Otherwise, you know, you are leading with a moral authority. And, you know, that is always a better way to handle a situation. And if there are people who do not follow, there were people who said, you know, we don't believe in meditation. We said, okay, perfectly okay. And we said, you know, there was a lot of alignment happening and, you know, that was creating very nice ecosystem there. And also what I say that about the time, it all depends that if you're always having a tension of time, that means somehow your relation with the time is that of scarcity. You know, we have only this much, how many thousands of seconds every day. But you believe that you have enough time, you know, the feeling of abundance. Then somewhere the nature is so intelligent, they will also tell you how to fix your priorities right. No, like I can share from my experience that I was these days devoting more time after this lockdown and all on the Facebook and LinkedIn, because I have so many connections, I have to devote time. Now today I decided I'm, you know, taking a break from Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter for at least 1 or 2 months. I have just put a simple message today and I'm going to be free by that. So I'm saying that any of your actions should not become your liability. Finally, you should be the boss, you know, and also you should have the freedom to live a life the way you like. So these are the things I just wanted to share. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr.
Wait. Mute. You're on mute.
Sorry. These are the perils of the technology. Sonia, please. I think...
yes. So we are ready to, I think, close. Although we have a couple of questions, but we have saved it in our system. And we are going to personally refer to those questions. I can clearly see there are a couple of questions for Dr. Krishna Venkatesh, and I'm going to write an email as a follow-up, and then we'll you know, get the answers and revert to individual, because we've been online for what, almost 2 hours now. But what a session. What a session. Mohit and I, when we were planning this, we were never so sure of that the session would be taken up so nicely and with so much of intriguing experience. And but I, you know, we were also sure, and Mohit is an avid reader. And when the first question was asked, I was almost thinking that Mohit is getting that itch to answer. He's getting that itch to answer about reading, because he's like, I think, Dr. Krishna Venkatesh. Mohit, what is your score of a yearly reading average?
No, I don't keep scores. Believe me, I don't read, because then you are not mindful in reading.
But he is, I know him now for a long, long time to really say this, that I have spoken to him about any story and he knows the book. Koi bhi kahani mein agar baat karti hu, kisi bhi kahani, oh yes, it's in that book. So obviously, I mean, goes on
to
say that.
Many times I have to show off as well, believe me.
Oh, please, come on. No, but coming back to the session on mindfulness, it's a huge pleasure and honor to be hosting such wonderful speakers, such wonderful guests. So in no particular order, thank you so much, Dr. Krishna Venkatesh, Dr. Pankaj Gupta, Rajiv Karwal, or as I should say, Mr. Rajiv Karwal. It never comes, Rajiv. I mean, मैं क्या करूं? मतलब मैंने प्रैक्टिस भी किया कि मैं इंट्रोडक्शन पे भी मिस्टर राजीव कारवाल बोलूंगी, वो निकला ही नहीं मेरे. सो आई एम रियली सॉरी मनिका, एंड ऑब्वियसली आई कैन नॉट साइन ऑफ विदाउट थैंकिंग मोहित फॉर ऑलवेज बीइंग देयर फॉर व्हाटएवर आइडिया यू ब्रिंग टू हिम, एंड ही इज सच अ स्वीटहार्ट इन टर्म्स ऑफ लिसनिंग, बीइंग ओपन. And yes, to say a go ahead, yes, CBL is always there to support such initiatives. And as I said in the middle of the event, that he's also bringing in a beautiful program, which is more structured around mindfulness as a holistic approach. So stay tuned on his webpage. You'll hear about this soon enough. I think that's it. So a very, very, very big thank you to each and every speaker for being there. And good night. For now, and we'll stay connected.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.